Hey guys, listen.
It's so quiet.
So good morning. It is Friday morning. It is a peacefully quiet time right now. It's about 11:30. Sitting down to film. My daughter is at preschool. My son is napping, so we have like the perfect time to film, and I'm so happy I waited until today to do it so that I could get through everything I want to get through in reasonable time. And it's quiet. Listen, there's no cars, there's no crazy TV shows or games going on in the other room. It's just silence. Any other parent with young toddlers will know that this is a precious time. So I am going to take advantage of that in every way possible. So good morning and welcome to my podcast. This is the Little Bean and Me podcast. I'm Kayleen. I am the principal fiber artist and dyer behind Little Bean Crochet and Little Bean Loves Hand-Painted Yarns. You can find me on most social media as Little Bean Crochet, on Instagram, on Facebook as Little Bean Crochet Shop, on Ravelry as KM Weaver, and I have an Etsy shop, which is littlebeancrochet.etsy.com. Welcome. Any new viewers, thanks so much for checking me out. I hope you really enjoy this podcast. Today is going to be very yarny. I don't have any like finished stuff, but there's lots of pretty dyed yarn and some questions. And any returning viewers, thanks for coming back. I hope you enjoy. It's a beautiful sunny day. As you can tell, it's quite bright. I'm super splotchy looking. No makeup. I don't care. Whatever. But yes, welcome back if you're returning and welcome if you're new. So we're just going to jump into everything. This week has been so busy with dyeing. I have gotten my mojo back. So if you're following any independent dyers on social media, you'll know that Sheena over at Casual Fashion Queen, she also has a podcast, which I'll link up here, but she has issued a challenge to some dyers this week saying, come on guys, let's just raise some anarchy in our dye pots and just dye what we want to dye, have fun doing it, don't take notes, and just go for it. And so this week, I just went for it. I did a little bit of a dye along in the group that I'm in, the fiber group that I'm in on Facebook, which those skeins just went bye-bye, out of the shop. Thank you for your orders, everybody. And it felt so good to just kind of, you know, say, don't put an expectation on myself, just have fun dyeing, something wonderful is going to come out of it, and you're just going to have fun. So that's what I did this week. So I really didn't get any crochet or knitting done because of that, but that's okay. I did finish some spinning, and I want to show you a little bit of that. So I suppose we'll just start with the spinning. Spinning it is. So as you know, I'm talking about my spinning mishap. If you guys have tuned in the last couple of episodes, I got a repaired spindle and I went to town spinning some fiber that is very pumpkin fall feeling, and I plied it. So here is my finished hand spun. This was fiber from Shirsty Cat Designs. I don't remember the color number, but it's just pumpkin colors. It's, you know, this nice mossy green and orange, and just ecru, the normal color of the yarn. And it spun together quite nicely. And so I started stitching with it as a single ply because I know I love a single ply. And I started stitching some mittens, which was my plan. I was knitting up the tin can knits mittens, the maze. If I'm right, if I'm wrong, I'll just correct it on the screen. But they are the fingerless mitts. Fingered or fingerless mitts. They could be mittens or fingerless mitts. And I was not liking how this was stitching up. The thick and thin spots were still a little too far apart, too drastic for me. I didn't really like how the fabric was working up, so I ripped it back and I thought, well, why don't I just ply what I have? So I took my two spun bundles that I had skeined up, I balled them both, and then I took those two balls and pulled from the center and then spun. So when I spin counterclockwise. And so I spun clockwise on my spindle and plied the fibers together to create this twist. And then I soaked it and set it, dried it, like hung it to dry. I didn't weight it. I let it dry a bit on the Nitty Knotty, and then while it was still damp, I just took it off and let the weight of the yarn kind of relax it, and I got these lovely spins. So this is kind of on a worsted to bulky weight type feel, I guess. You know, some of this is a little, like this is a little more worsted weight, and then this is obviously very bulky, chunky yarn. You still have some slubbly bits in there, but I'm very happy with how this came out. I had a lot of people cheering me on, so thank you guys for all your support and my little spinning adventure. So I'm trying to find something that I really want to make with this, whether I want to knit something or crochet something. I haven't decided, but this is right on the forefront of I'm going to use it because I love it. I think it looks so great. So that was my first spin. I was also very inspired, although I don't have time to do it because the kids are always around. I suppose now if I wanted to throw on some Star Wars, I could participate in the Sithin spin, which if you haven't heard, Freakish Lemon, he's doing, Adrian is doing the Sithin spin, where it's just a casual spin along and you watch or listen to or read any Star Wars that has Sith in it. And you know, you submit your finished spinning work. So I was going to participate in that, but I don't really have the time to sit around and watch Star Wars or listen to Star Wars because I always have to be on with kids. And then by the time the kids go to bed, I'm ready for bed. So it's a vicious cycle. But anyway, I was very inspired to continue doing it by his podcast and by the other folks who were cheering me on Instagram and Facebook groups and everything. So thank you very much for your inspiration. I am very pleased with my outcome and I'm happy to keep spinning. I can't wait to pick up my spindle again. So that's that. As far as acquisitions, I have so many things that are coming some things I can tell you that are coming, and then some things I want to save for a little surprise. But so this week I went shopping. We did a little swapsies. Georgianne from the Stitching Plaza sent me. I sent her yarn and she sent me something to hold yarn. So she said, which bag would you like? And I said, give me Gryffindor. Gryffindor! She sent me a Gryffindor bag. So this is just, this is a lovely fabric inside. It's, I don't think it's metallic. Well, it's a little metallic, yeah. Oh yeah, there you can see the sheen. It's this lovely metallic inner. See if I can grab her card for you. Here it is. So this is from the Stitching Plaza on Etsy. She recently just did a shop update, but it's a simple drawstring bag. It has a nice square bottom. It's very sturdy. So like even when you don't have anything in it, it will stand up on its own. So you can tell she puts some kind of interfacing, something for stability in the bag, which is really nice. I appreciate that. And you can feel it too in the inner part of the bag that when you open it fully, it'll stand up on its own. It won't collapse upon itself. And then the other thing that I like about, I wasn't sure if I was gonna like zippers or drawstrings better because I don't really have that big of a collection of project bags, but I like that when you fold this down, you can still see this and it's a nice wide open place. So let's see if I can show you. This can probably fit 3 balls of yarn, but 2 balls, that's 200 grams, fits with plenty of room for a project. So I'd say this is, you know, a moderate size bag. There's plenty of squish room in there for a project. And yeah, you can just go from there. It's a really awesome bag. I don't know if I'm going to keep it or if I'm going to do a little giveaway or do a bundle in the shop where you can get a bag and yarn together. I don't know what, I haven't decided what I want to do with this bag yet. I love it. It's my colors, it's my house. But I fear that I won't use it only because I don't have tons of active knit or crochet projects, and crochet projects go so quickly for me that often I don't even need a bag. I literally just put the stuff on the couch next to me, crochet what I need, and then put my extra yarn away. So we'll see. We'll see the future of this bag, but this is a beautiful bag from Stitching Plaza. If you haven't gone to check her out, you should. I'm very pleased with the product that she sent to me. It is gorgeous. Gorgeous, well-constructed bag. So that's all I have for active acquisitions. I have some more bags coming that I ordered, some stitch markers that I ordered from Melissa. The bags are from Molly Klein. And then I have a large order of stitch markers coming from my dear friend Lori. I put in a large order with her to send me some of her hand-designed stitch markers. She's a glass artist, so she does glass blowing and lamp working. She hand makes every single bead on her jewelry, and every piece of glass that comes out of her hot shop is directly from her. It's not just a charm or something that you've bought. So these are extremely finely crafted stitch markers. She's super talented, and I'm so excited. I've been dreaming about these stitch markers. So I chatted with her. I said, hey, you know, what if I, are you able to fill a large order for me? And she said, of course. So she's working on that order. And so you might see some stitch markers in some gift sets from me and some giveaway stuff, and maybe popped in as a surprise if you order from me. So we'll see. We'll see. I am so stoked about it. And they are gorgeous. Gorgeous. I'm going to put a picture here of some of the sets that she has. I don't know if they're up on her website yet. She's, you know, solo mio. She works by herself and she manages all of her website and, you know, everything by herself. So she's working on getting it up. I'm not sure if it is at the time that you're watching this, but she's just brilliant. You should follow her on Facebook and Instagram and all the places because she's lovely. So yeah, so I have stitch markers coming from Melissa, which are just love, like wonderful. I like love her stitch markers. They're so cute, little charms, and just like every little thing that you could want. And then from Molly, I have those project bags coming. So I have some Doctor Who stuff coming, and I have some other cute bags with like this awesome Halloween print I'm very excited about. I went on a binge this morning. I shouldn't have done it, but I did. So anyway, let's go into the Ask Me Anything thread. So I ask on Instagram and Facebook, and I also have a thread open in the Ravelry group. If you have not seen the Ravelry group, definitely check out the links below. If you search for Littlebean and Me podcast in the groups tab on Ravelry, there is some open threads in there to join up and submit some questions, introduce yourself. We have a very casual knit along / crochet along going on for Halloween right now, which is open until the end of October. So there's tons of time. As long as you started your project after August 1st, then you can submit it in. It's super casual, just spooky things, spooky themed yarn or spooky themed pattern or something that's, you know, Halloween related. So it's just there to have fun. But anyway, so I have threads open everywhere for Ask Me Anything. This morning I once again solicited for some questions, and if you follow me on Instagram, you know that I have tons of yarn that I'm going to talk about today, but we have a huge shop update tomorrow, and so I got a lot of yarn related questions this week. Last week I didn't have any questions. This week I have a ton of yarn related questions, and I'm happy to answer them all. So let's just go at it. So I already checked other social medias. I don't have anything on Facebook or on Ravelry, but I do have a few questions on Instagram. So I'm going to look here and pull those questions up. Yay! Oh, and my husband asked a question too. It's actually a really good question, so I'm going to answer it, but he's so sweet. I said, are you going to submit a question this week? Do you want to know anything? You know, and he's in this with me, so like he knows everything that goes on, but he's like, I want to submit a question. Maybe it'll be weird. I'm like, other people want to know. If you have a curious question, then other people are probably going to have the same type of question, so you're free to ask. So he did. I put it up and he asked something, so I'm all happy about that. Okay, so we have several questions. Instagram user inspired_professor. This is Caroline. She asked two questions. I've never used hand-dyed wool before, but purchased recently from you. Yes, you have. And noticed that it has a distinctive smell. Not very pleasing for me anyway. How can I remove this once a garment is made? Also, I purchased Hobbit Feet a while back. That was a gradient cake. I love the color, but wanted to ask if you had any recommendations for making socks so that I get two of the same. I only purchased one cake. Great, I can answer both those questions for you, Caroline, totally fine. So I will answer the first question first. So you're asking about the wool smell. So wool has a distinct smell. It smells like sheep. Most yarns, once you dye them and dry them, you're not gonna smell too much. Me, I am very much used to the smell of wool right now. When I first started dyeing, I was like, oh my God, I can't stand that smell. I don't even know what that smell is. Ugh, it's all wet wool and all I can smell is wool. So I can't judge too much on wool smell. But I'll give you a little bit of background on how I process the yarn when I'm dyeing it so that you can have an idea of, you know, why your wool may smell a little woolier or not smell very much at all, because there are a lot of factors that go into if your yarn is going to have a smell too much or not. Like this one smells a little woolly, but this is merino and cashmere. I smell wool. So when I dye the yarn, you know, it's heated over the stove and we have, you know, the dyes that go in, it's in a citric like acidy solution, so it's not just straight up water, it's more acidic. It sets the dye, the heat sets the dye, and then when it comes out of the pot, it cools down and it goes into a bath. And what I use to wash the wool is eucalan, so I'll put it on the screen here. It's E-U-C-L-A-N, eucalan, and it is an unscented wool wash. And it's gentle soap that I use to clean out the wool, to clean out all the citric acid, if there's any buildup of citric acid in there. And that cleaner also has a little bit of lanolin in it, so it helps to condition the wool so it doesn't feel very stripped, just like you would condition your hair. I mean, this is sheep's hair. So lanolin is the natural oils that are in the sheep's wool, so it's nice to put that back in the wool. The wool smell that you have with yarn, it's not as strong as it usually is with, say, roving or, you know, other types of just raw fiber. For example, the fleece that I had spun last week, that small sample that Wisteria sent me from Lucky Pluck, had a very, very, very strong, woolly, sheepy smell. It smelled like a sheep. Like, if I put it up to my nose, I'm like, wow, this is a sheep. That's because it was freshly shorn, freshly processed, barely, you know, washed out or anything. It was very waxy, lanolin-y, you know, that kind of smell and texture. So that contributes to the smell, which is like, how much is it processed? So if it's coming right from the sheep, freshly shorn, freshly spun, it's gonna have a stronger wool smell than a yarn, like a yarn that's been processed, cleaned, you know, kind of put through the ringer, so to speak, spun up, washed, dried, skeined, dried, shipped out, then dyed and washed and everything again, you know, it takes away some of the smell. Things that can contribute to your wool smelling a little more, having a woolier type of smell. when wool is wet, it smells like wet sheep. I'm used to the smell because I smell it every single day from dyeing every day. But if there is moisture still in the wool, and it's, say, I process the wool, I dry the wool, and then I package it to ship it to you, it's in a sealed plastic bag, going through the elements. So the heat, the cold, humid, not humid, and it's subject to the environment. So when I dye the wool and I dry it, how fast it dries is dependent upon the weather. I dry my yarn on a drying rack with a fan blowing on it so that it dries more quickly and more thoroughly. But if there was any moisture left in the wool and you pull it out of the package and it has a very distinctive wool smell, it means that the wool still had a little moisture trapped inside. So I find that the single ply dry the fastest because it's not twisted up on itself. If you feel it, I can usually tell if something is still damp, but if there's still moisture trapped inside, it'll make the wool smell woolier because it's still moist. It still has some moisture in it. You know, this has 4-ply in it, and I find that things that are thinner. So this is another 4-ply. This is the DK Luxe, and this is the Sock Luxe. It takes a little longer to dry because the yarn is twisted up on itself. So there's more places where moisture can hide. So that's another thing that affects it. So moisture will affect how your wool smells. If you received your wool and you find it's too woolly smelling, I had yours were caked up. You can always skein them up on a knitting noddy or on your arm, like just wrap them around your arm, take them out of the ball, and hang them to dry and to air out and to get all the moisture that's in out, and that will help. The other thing that will help is using a wool wash that might have a little bit of a scent. So say it doesn't really smell strongly, but you just don't like the smell of the wool. When you wash and block and soak, use a wool wash that has some kind of smell. So Eucalan comes in different scents. I use unscented because I'm sensitive to smell, and I know that other people are sensitive to smell as well, so I'm not going to use something like lavender or grapefruit or eucalyptus because not everybody is jiving with that. So if you want something to smell, you can always add a scent to this by using a scented wash. So soak is one wash that doesn't have lanolin in it, but they do come in different scents. And also Eucalan is one that I definitely would recommend. So say you take your wool, you put it into a skein, you hang it out for a couple of days, smell it, make sure everything is aired out. If you're still not feeling the smell, what you could do is take your wool and soak it, and wash it a little bit in some scented wool wash, dry it again, and then see if you care for the smell. And I would recommend doing that if you have it in a skein that's tied off so that you can just soak it and then hang it to dry. And then once it's nice and dry, then you can ball it up to use it and make your garment. And then when you block your garment, also use the scented wool wash so that you can continue having that smell in the wool, and it will cover up any lamb woolly smell that you don't like, and it will help freshen and keep your wool conditioned. So that's a little bit about the process. It does happen. So I'm a human being. I do my best to make sure that every single skein that leaves my house is completely dry before it is sent out, because nobody wants to open up their wool and get like a smelly, you know, where it's really strongly smelling of like just like musty wool, wet wool smell. So I would say do those things, see if that helps. Not everybody likes the smell of wool. I don't like the really woolly smell, you know, that fiber I spun and it was really woolly smelling. Like, I don't really like that. So it's like I would wash that out, try and get out some of the lanolin, try and get out some of the smell, and maybe use a scented wash and make sure it's completely dry before I use it. So that's the answer to that question. Hopefully I answered it well. If I didn't, please send me a message, and I'm happy to answer and try and help anything else further. And then the second question you asked was, you purchased Hobbit Feet, which was a double-stranded wound cake. So I'll pop a picture here. And that you had questions about making socks so that you get two of the same sock. So that particular cake of yarn, it comes like this, was double-stranded. So what that means, I posted a video about it a couple of podcasts ago, so if you haven't seen it, I would say go back there. I'll link the timestamp below to the where I specifically talked about it. But it's intended to knit two socks at a time. So if you see the center pull, it marks the center of the yarn, and then the outer pull marks the outer part of the yarn. So there are two ends on the outside and two ends on the inside. So you would knit two socks at the same time from the same place, and you'll get matching socks. If you can't, or you don't know how to knit two socks at the same time, you can separate the yarn and have somebody help you and just make two separate balls of the yarn. So you wind a little here, wind a little there, wind a little here, wind a little there, and then you're gonna end up with two identical balls of yarn. One skein, one sock skein, 100 grams, is usually enough for two socks, one distinct pair of socks. As long as you're doing average size socks, you're not doing these crazy thigh high socks. But if you're doing like a normal sized pair of socks, a 100 gram skein is plenty of yardage to do two socks. So the cake that you purchased is 100 grams, And the way that I spun the yarn into the cake, it gives you two ends on the inside and two ends on the outside. And they start from the same point. So you can knit two socks at the same time from the center or two socks at the same time from the outside. And if you can't, knit two at the same time if you don't know how, or if it's too challenging for you, you can knit one at a time, but I would recommend is taking your yarn. If it's not snipped in the middle for those two middle ends, you can snip it and just say you and your daughter go and just wind two balls out at the same time so that you get two separate balls that are identical, and then when you start those two balls, you're going to get two identical socks. I hope that makes sense. Lynn from the Sunshine and Bubblegum podcast is using the double-stranded cake right now to knit her Hermione's Everyday socks, her Hermione Weasley socks. So you should check her latest episode. She does talk about it there, or on Instagram. She's Sunshine Bubblegum, and I'll put a link to her Instagram profile below. And you can always ask her how it's going, because she's the only one I know so far that is working from the double-stranded cake. But that's how it's intended. Or if you're using it, if you actually knit those two strands together, like use them at the same time, it actually equals a DK or a double knit weight. So if you have a pattern that's, you know, for DK, for one skein of DK, then you could also use it that way. But it's intended to knit two separate strands at once from the same point. So two strands from the middle, one becomes one sock, one becomes the other, or two strands from the outside. It depends how you like to work. So that's that. I hope that also answers your question. And anybody else who has purchased a double-stranded cake from me before, I hope if you're confused or you're not sure how to use it, then you can, you know, message me below or send me a message on Instagram or Etsy, and I'm always happy to help. Okay, so we're 30 minutes in. Let's see here. So Melissa from Knitty by Nature. Hey, Melissa. Asks me, do you have any suggestions on ways to knit your mini skein sets? Yes. Let me grab a mini skein set to show you. Okay, so this is a mini skein set. Most mini skein sets that I put out are 5 full 20 grams. So you get 100 grams of yarn, which is enough for two pairs of socks, or, you know, if you're working on a scrap blanket or whatever, there's plenty of each color to do a square. More than enough color. I mean, more than enough. I think you usually need around 5 grams to do one of those cozy squares, so you have plenty of yarn here. So this is a full 100 gram set, and usually it comes with different colors that are either related in theme or related in, you know, their own family. So Hobbit Feet, I think, is only 4, but it's all like green and brown. And then Honeydukes is all these really strong pastel, like very saturated tones. So like a baby blue and a bright pink and just like cool things. So this is Halloween candy, and this is going up tomorrow at 1, and I'll talk more about that in the shop update. But I would say that to use these, 20 gram, a single one of these is enough to do heels and toes on a pair of socks. So say you're working on, so this is the Smarties candy, or Rockets. I think they're called Rockets in Canada. But they're those chalky candies that everybody eats but nobody really likes. So say you're doing a pair of pink socks and you want to use this for your heels and toes. You knit up your socks and then you would use this as that contrasting color. So there's enough in a 20 gram skein to do heels and toes for a single pair of socks. I'm not sure how many heels and toes you can get out of it because I'm not a sock knitter, but any of you mini lovers out there, that's what these are for. So there are different patterns that are also available that use, you know, kind of like scrappy type things. So if you have tons of leftover yarn, you can do like the Franken socks hat, or the Pixels Rise sock, where you're using multiple colors from, you know, just scraps of yarn. And these are great for that because you're getting a whole bunch of different colors and you work them in any way that you want. So use them as accents, use them as the main body of your project. So Franken socks hat or Pixel Rise socks, just examples. You can use them in a Cozy Memories blanket. You can use them as border or trim. If you're doing a particular project, say you had knit a pink, like a small pink blankie, you could use this to trim up your piece. That's what you can use them for. And I like minis because they're colorful and like they're these little happy things like, what can I use this for? But also a lot of people like to do minis swaps. So around the holidays, people will, you know, break up these 20 gram minis into like 5 gram or 10 gram skeins, and then you swap them with your friends. So it's kind of like a trading card game where you can collect minis and then swap them out with your friends to see, you know, like, oh, I have 10 grams of this, you want to swap for this? You know, so it's kind of fun. And it's just the little creative accent in your project. So that's what I like to do with minis. I've yet to put them in socks because I don't knit socks, but I do want to make a Franken socks hat. So, or Franken head hat, whatever it's called. I'll put the prompt, you know. Yeah, I'll do all the things. I'll edit and put the information. So that's what I would suggest. Anyway, wow, I just got really close. Let's get really close. Okay, and then we have Shanna. She is callmeq_89 on Instagram. She's also a dyer. She asks me, what technique do you use to speckle your yarn and setting it? I've seen a few different methods, so I'm just curious. Okay, so I will let you know. The method that I prefer to use to speckle my yarn, this one, you can see all the speckles that are on here. I dye my yarn in a regular pot. You know, I can only do 2 skeins at a time. I could squeeze 4 skeins in there, but 2 skeins is comfortable. So what I do is I sprinkle the dye powder onto my skeins when they're in the pot. And if I'm wanting to speckle an entire skein, I'll put 1 skein in at a time and have really low water so that the dye doesn't get too much into the water and kind of like bleed out and alter the color of the yarn that's already in there or the ecru yarn that's there, so it doesn't taint what I'm trying to achieve, like the effect I'm trying to go for. So this yarn is part of the shop release. I'll talk more about it there, but okay. Ooh, I gotta back up to show. So this is the color down the rabbit hole that's going up tomorrow. But you can see that there are a couple different techniques that I've used to dye this piece, but this is the part that is speckled. So when I dyed it, the rest of this was in the pot, and then this was at the top of the pot, at the top of the water. And so I speckled on the colors that I wanted. You can see there are many colors of speckles on there, there's greens and aquas and yellows and blues. And then what I do is I try to get all sides of the yarn. So what ends up happening a lot of the time is if people are dyeing their things laying flat like this, and they are, they're only speckling one side, you'll often see half the skein is more boldly colored and the other half is not as boldly colored, and I don't care for that. So the way I dye it is I try to get speckles on through the entire skein of yarn, so that when you're crocheting or knitting something with it, that it's evenly distributed. And then to set, I'm setting it right in the pot. So the water is hot, it's at the temperature it needs to be to set the dye. And so while I'm speckling, you know, the yarn isn't moving, everything is nice and still setting in there, and I let it just sit and set into the yarn. And then once I'm sure that the dye has set and it's not bleeding or coming out of the fiber anymore, I make sure to submerge it in the water and make sure that the heat gets to that part of the yarn to set the speckle. Because these are very saturated spots of color. Whether you thicken your dye or you're speckling the dry powder on top of your yarn, you're getting a very strong area of color. And with that comes the risk of bleeding. So I always set the yarn and make sure it's completely set into the fiber and make sure that the heat gets into that part of the fiber. Especially if I'm using something that has lower water, I'll make sure to get it submerged or rotate the yarn so that every part of the yarn is getting evenly warmed and set. So that's how I do it. Other people will lay their yarn out like hand painted on, they'll drip color onto the yarn or thicken the dye so that when it drops into the water, it'll drop in at a thicker, more viscous consistency. It's a tough technique. I've struggled with this technique, and I'm only just coming into it now where I'm really getting much better at speckling. So there's some nice speckles here. This whole entire skein is speckled. There's some subtle speckling on this one. There's speckles. I think there's speckles on almost every skein that's in here. But like all of this is speckled. So I'm getting better at it as a fiber professional, but it's definitely worth experimenting. If you're like a Kool-Aid dyer, like you dye your own yarn, you use Kool-Aid or whatever fun food coloring, play around with it. Like Kool-Aid powder would be kind of fun to try and like sprinkle onto the yarn and see if you can get some speckles without too much bleeding. So it's a combination of the heat, the water level, and then the method of putting the speckles on the yarn. And if it's not, like if the water's not acidic enough, or it's not hot enough, or it's too hot and rolling, or it's, you know, too acidic or whatever, like there's this tenuous balance that comes into speckling. So that makes it happen. And so even, let's see another speckled, oh no, don't, here we go. So here's more speckling. And these are on thicker yarns. There's speckling on this, which is the spice. There's speckles. There's not too much speckling on this. There's a bit of speckling. This has some really bold speckles. Like most of the yarn is purple. This is another one that's going up in the shop, which I'll talk about later, but to show you the speckles that are on this as well. So when I dyed it, this was toward the top. Like this was in the water. This was toward the top of the water. I used a lower water level and I sprinkled the dye powder on it. Red, ooh, red, and green and yellow and all the colors that I wanted to speckle this with. So you get a nice variation. This one is called We're All Mad Here. So, and this is the yarn that's in the picture for the Ask Me Anything on Instagram. So if you've seen that picture, or if you haven't seen that picture, go on Instagram and check it out and you can see what it looks like in the picture. But I try to represent the colors very accurately. I feel like on video I'm able to get the most accurate colors, but that's this speckled. Speckledy-doo. I enjoy speckled yarns. I kind of like this. Something that I'm not really keen on speckles, but I'm keen on those. Okay, so then we have my husband's question. He asks, what style of yarn is easiest to dye? Like if you were starting, is one easier than another? And the answer is yes. Animal fibers are by far the easiest to dye. All you need is heat, acid, and color. So food coloring and vinegar is the easiest way to dye a wool. So say you have a blank skein of wool at home and you want to mess around, put some water in a pot, put a couple tablespoons of vinegar in there, and then drop some food coloring in, put your yarn in, and see what comes out. That's probably the easiest way to do it. There are a lot of tutorials online that talk about using Kool-Aid to dye yarn or Easter egg tablets to dye yarn. And it's certainly a fun thing to do at home, to do with your kids because it's food safe, that you could do in your own pots because it's food safe. As far as like professional quality dyes, these are not food safe. These need to be used with extreme caution. You need to wear breathing protection, gloves. I'm always pretty good about wearing gloves, but I end up getting dye on my fingers or arms or clothes. But these are they require much more equipment, and though they're much more saturated, they're like more volatile. Should you inhale the powder? The most dangerous part about dyeing, like using commercial and professional quality dyes, is that they come in powder form. And if you inhale the powder, it's not very good for you, which is why you have to wear breathing protection. And they easily stain your hands, so you don't want to get your hands all in the powder or in the dye stock that you make and get it all over the place. So it's easiest to dye. Protein fibers take the color the easiest. Plant fibers are more difficult, so things like cotton or bamboo. Dyeing those requires a different set of dyes, different chemicals. They have different requirements in terms of like the chemistry of what it's going to take to have the dye saturate and get into the fiber. It's more difficult, and it is harder to judge when something is fully saturated because the dyes don't fully exhaust. So when you're dyeing something like wool, the dye in the bath will get soaked up into the wool, and you'll see your dye water is clear. Once the dye water is clear, you know that all the dye is gone and you know it's all in the fiber. With plant-based fibers, it doesn't exhaust. So you still have a dye, you still have a pot full of dye that you have to rinse away and rinse away and rinse away, clean, rinse away, rinse away, rinse away, until there's no more dye coming out of the fiber. So that's the most difficult one, I think, is plant fibers. So that's why I chose to dye wool. I like working with wool, but that's why you don't see a ton of independently dyed plant fibers, because it's much more difficult. So I hope that answers your question well, and if anybody else was wondering that, I hope that answers your question. I don't think I have any other questions here. Let me refresh the page and see. And I don't have any more questions. Okay. And then I'll do a little bit of like Blabber and some shop update stuff. So if you are not interested in any of that, then I'll see you next time. And if you are, just stay where you are. You're in the right place. But I'm going to talk about the yarn that's going up tomorrow and also things that are going on in our lives. So yeah. So if you're not interested in that, we'll see you next time. But just sit tight, I guess. We'll just talk about some personal stuff. So this last week, I filmed my podcast on Thursday. I don't even remember at this point. But Friday last week was Cece's first day of preschool. It went really well. I'll put her picture here. She was so cute. She held up her little board. My first day of school. A little bit emotional. Not so bad. I was watching Lynn. Her podcast, she just posted up. There's a truck. You probably can hear that. She was talking about her twins. They started school last week too, and we were chatting on Instagram, like, oh no, our babies are growing up. But it was the same situation with us as it was with her guys. You know, Cece got there and she was like, peace, I'm leaving. And I'm like, where's mommy's hug? I want a hug. So Tyler and I both went. Ty took the day off of work, which was really nice, and we went and dropped her off. She gives hugs and kisses, and it was probably 95 degrees and 100% humidity outside. It was like the hottest day of the year, and it was her first day of school, and we went to pick her up, and she's wearing just like a t-shirt dress and shorts and whatever, sneakers. She is drenched in sweat. This kid is such a sweaty kid, and both Tyler and I are like sweaty people. You know, when it's really hot outside, like, we're dripping sweat off our forehead. Like, it's just how it is. And so she comes up and her hair is all matted around her neck. Mommy, mommy, mommy. And I'm like, you are overheated. What's going on? So the teachers told us, like, oh yeah, she overheated. Is she like a kid that gets really hot? And I'm like, yeah, well, it is 95 degrees outside. Maybe you shouldn't be playing out in the hot heat. So to be fair, the play yard is kind of shaded, so it's really not, it wasn't that bad, but it was like, why did you take her out? Why did you let her play outside in that heat? But she had fun. She was all smiles the whole way home. She's been talking about her first day of school all week long, telling me about how she ate lunch and the boy told her to stop eating and, oh, she sang songs and she played on the slide and blah, blah, the whole thing. And so today, she gets up and I say, oh, Cece, today's Friday, it's time to go to school. She's like, I'm gonna stay home today. I'm like, what are you talking about? I'm going to stay home today and play with Grammy and Ayla. And I'm like, Grammy and Ayla aren't coming over today to play. They are like my mother-in-law nannies for a little girl. And I was like, yeah, they're not coming over today. You're going to school. She was so disappointed that she wasn't going to stay home and just play. And then once she kind of got over that, she was like, oh yeah, I'm going to school and I'm going to pack my lunch and let me get dressed. I'm going to pick my outfit for school and I love this school clothes, my new school clothes. Okay, have fun with that. So our drop off went pretty well. She got dropped off a few hours ago. So it was nice. It was nice. We'll see how her pickup goes today. Hopefully it goes pretty smoothly, but that's what's big in our lives. And then I've been dying all week, only figuratively or literally, I guess, not like I'm dying. You know, I'm just dying. I've been over the dye pot all week. So I'll talk about a shop update now, I suppose. So tomorrow there's a huge shop update. If you saw at the beginning of the podcast that huge pile of yarn, that's what's going to be in the update. I still have some tagging to do and pictures to take and processing to do. Like, I have to divide these up. This is 100 grams. I need to divide them in half, so I still have 3 skeins to divide in half. So I'm going to show you everything, or pretty much everything that's going to be in the shop update. I'm not going to show you every single base that it'll be on, because that probably will take too long. We'll see. So we have, it's kind of like in threes. So we have Sheena's challenge, her Anarchy Dye Pots challenge, which is going to be, for me, Sherlock themed. It only came about after dyeing. You know, I kind of went in, dyed the yarn, and then I was like, ooh, I like this for Sherlock. And so I ended up naming all the yarns of Sherlock. They're all going to be on the Luxe sock base, which is the 80-10-10 MCN. So if you're shopping tomorrow and you want to get your hands on the Sherlock yarns, go to the Luxe sock section, because that's where they are going to be. One, two, three, four. There are four. Okay. So these are the Sherlock yarns. That was very awful to show. This is Sherlocked. That's the name of this color. It's not a repeatable colorway. There are only two going up on each color. So if you like the color, then you need to snatch it while it's there. So that's the color. It is kind of a blue, gray, speckly, doodah kind of yarn. It's really beautiful. It is obviously named for the title character of Sherlock, in particular the Benedict Cumberbatch version of Sherlock with his steely blue eyes. So that is that color. The next one is Mrs. Hudson. I'm taking the bands off so that they're not just sitting on there. This is Mrs. Hudson. This is showing up a little bolder. Well, I suppose it's that bold, but it's a mauve color. It is a tonal, so it's all one color. It's not multiple colors, it's just tones of the same. So it's a relatively high contrast tonal. There's some nice deep mauve colors, mauve, however you want to say it, but it's a beautiful tonal, and totally reminded me of Mrs. Hudson. And again, this is not repeatable. This was dye in the pot and let's see what happens. So I did not take notes on this color. What is that? Get out of here. Mrs. Hudson, again, it's on the Luxe sock base. There are only two that are going to be up and available. The next one is the Red Woman, or not the Red Woman, the Woman. Crossing my fandoms here. This is the Woman. So aptly named. It's a very seductive reddish colored skein. It's a variegated skein. Again, only two are available. I only did one dye lot, hence Anarchy. But here it is. It's got speckles. It's got deep dark red, winey, purpley kind of tones. They look almost black. It's not black. It's actually very, very deep kind of aubergine color. There's some orange in here, but not very much. Mostly reds, peach tones. It's showing up pretty true to life here. So very variegated, quite lovely, very, very soft. So that's the Woman. And then the last one, which is my favorite, this is 221B, named for the famous flat of Sherlock Holmes. So when I dyed this, it was going to be something different, and it turned into this. It's getting washed out, but I just want you to be able to see all the variations in color. It's very dark colorway, but it's got, everything is kind of like this antiqued tone. So this was made with 3 colors. And like, look at all the colors that came out of it. Literally blew my mind. my favorite color that I've made so far. I'm very sad that it's not repeatable. I can try to repeat it, I guess, but I named it 221B because it reminded me of the wallpaper and the furniture and just the atmosphere of Sherlock's flat. So that is 221B. Quite nice. Also on Lux Sock, and only two are available. There you go. That's a little accurate to color. I mean, it gets washed out when it comes closer, but you can see all the variation in tone. It's much brighter right here than it is in real life. This is more like real life. It's very variegated. Not as high contrast as this, obviously. You can see there are very bright, bright spots and very dark spots. This is much more deep. So I want to show these together because in the pictures they seem to look very similar, but they are different. The woman, 221B. They're different. I'm taking the pictures and I'm looking back at the pictures saying, like, are these the same yarn? But they're not the same yarn. They look very different. It's just hard to get a very accurate picture in a still photo, especially for me in what I'm using. So I like showing the yarn here on the podcast because then you get a really good idea. I don't want it to get washed out. But those are the two colors. The woman's on top, 221B is on the bottom. And then the other color that's very similar in my collection is Wigan Tree. Now, Wigan Tree is different. It has green in it. It is not as dark. So, even though they look very similar, they are not the same. This is Wigan Tree. This is repeatable. This is much more purple and orange, and there's some green in there. This is 221B. You can see the difference here. This is repeatable, these are not. So, Wigan Tree, 221B, the woman. Just so you have an idea of the palette and what it looks like and that they're not the same yarn, they don't look the same. Let's get it back here. There you go. That's a pretty good screenshot there. So you can see all of those things, they are not the same. So these four, two are available on each base. They're going in the Lux Sock section. So if you like Sherlock and you want to get your, oh, they're so soft. Wait, we'll do the Mina. We'll do the Mina. go to Lux Sock section. Look for these. These are one of a kind, one dye lot only, never repeatable again. Very sad. Maybe one day I'll try to repeat these, but not anytime soon. These were just for fun. Okay, so then the next kind of theme that's going up is the Alice in Wonderland theme, which I've showed a couple of skeins for, and I will show them again, and there are two. There's only two available of each. So this is, we are all mad here. And this I may repeat in the future, but not anytime soon. This was also kind of like an experimental dye. I didn't know what I was going to get out of it. I kind of had an idea of what I wanted to do, but I wasn't going to take strict notes. But I have this lovely purple with these bold colored speckles. Quite beautiful and striking. I think this will crochet or knit up into a lovely hat or mitts or something like that. You know, something like a statement piece or a cowl. That would be really cool. There are going to be two of these available only on the Simple DK base. So if you want this yarn, go to the Simple DK section tomorrow at 1. They're going to be there. That's the only two that are available. No others were dyed in this process. That's kind of a good view. It's got some really, it's that ombre effect. So the really deep fading into the lighter purples and then this lovely speckling. So Simple DK base, only two are available. We are mad here. That's the color. Excuse me. The next color, this is called Down the Rabbit Hole. I keep going to the wrong side. I switched my camera from last week again. This is Down the Rabbit Hole. It was dyed in a similar way. Again, I didn't go in with a thought of what I was going to, I didn't have this huge concept in my mind. I kind of just dyed what I felt like dyeing and things that I thought would go well together. So again, we have this lovely blue color fading into these speckles. So you can see there the contrast. It's greens and yellows. Kind of reminds me of Alice's dress. The blue reminds me of Alice's dress. And again, these names came after the fact. Like, I sat and looked at the yarn and I'm like, what can I name this as? Like, this is the opposite way as I usually do things. Usually I grab a concept and then I go from there. This I dyed and then I made the concept later. I thought what I thought would fit. So this is Down the Rabbit Hole, Alice in Wonderland theme. This is on the Luxe DK base. There are only two available. They're not going to be repeated for a very long time. I don't plan on repeating this. So if you like it, go grab it on Luxe DK. There are two. That's it. Once they're gone, they're gone. So tomorrow at 1, this is one you like. Go to Luxe DK section and you'll find this. Okay, and then the last part of the Alice in Wonderland is a 200 gram set. It's only going to be on the Everyday Sock base. There are only two available. This I can repeat. I probably won't repeat it for a while because it's more of a springtime feel. But again, I just went into it dyeing what I felt like dyeing and then seeing what came out the other side. So, which was the theme for the whole week. This is the, Golden Afternoon. That's it. I'm singing the song. So this is Golden Afternoon. It is a little bit like a lily. So this purple is an ombre style. Again, I went in just thinking like, I'm gonna dye this ombre purple. Why not? So it's an ombre purple. So it's a shorter color transition. So you're gonna get some cool pooling effects with this. I love ombres. So this is a 50 gram skein. The next skein is yellow, but it has a slight orange tint and small speckles, not a ton of speckles. I didn't want to go too speckly crazy on this yellow, but you'll notice that there are some speckles in here. They're very faint. I don't know if you can see them. Try and get it on. There are very few speckles. But again, I wanted to show the yellow, but I didn't want it to be like highlighter yellow. So I added orange, like I sprinkled the dye in there, and I ended up getting some small speckles, which I like. Kind of reminds me of like the inside of the flower, you know, with the pollen and stuff that's in there. So this is a 50 gram skein. So you get two 50 gram skeins and then 100 gram skein. So this is a green tonal. This is just the plain, just green, just a nice, cheerful, kind of grassy green. So it's like a flower, it's like a lily. So this would be perfect for a shawl. So if you're doing a simple style shawl or a shawl that has, you know, some cool eyelets or whatever, you know, you start with your green and then you work your way out and then you have the flower colors here. Or you can start with the flower colors and then you end with green. I thought that was really cool to do. So that's a whole set. So in total, you're getting about 900 yards, yeah, somewhere around 900 yards of fiber here, because one of these is 463, so 463 times 2 is 8, 9, 926. So yeah, so that's going to be in the Everyday Sock section. Only two are available. If you want it, you should go grab it tomorrow at 1. Okay, so those are the two main thingamabobbies that are going on. And then I have some other stuff that are more like, some things that are like autumn related. Autumn, wow, I really sounded like Rhode Islander from there. Okay, I'm from Rhode Island and I'm sorry, sometimes I slip into this weird Rhode Island hybrid accent that happens. Like I just said, autumn, which doesn't happen to me very often because I've been out of Rhode Island since 2002 pretty much. When I go home, oh boy. Anyway, so there are some autumn things, And then there's some dialong things that I was able to replicate. So the dialong that I worked on last week was the omelets at midnight. It's going to be hard to show this because it's such a deep color. This is on Sparkle. This will only be available on Sparkle. This was a photo. Here we go. That's more true to life. This is this was from a photo inspiration. So I'll put a picture here. This was the photo. And then this is the resultant yarn. So I only had dyed two last week, and everybody asked me to do it again. And I said, I will try. I can't guarantee it, but I was able to do it. So I posted in the group and I said, listen, I'm gonna have a few of these available on Saturday. I was able to replicate it on Sparkle. And so there are some people who are already gunning for this. If this is something you like, go to the Sparkle section, Sparkle Sock. This is what's available. There are three skeins of this available. It's repeatable. There we go. I'm sorry about that. It's repeatable. So I can repeat this. I'm probably not going to dye it for a while because it's not really, you know, it's a little, I might dye it sometime in the winter, but for now it's not really that time of year yet. So it's very beautiful. It's a nice deep purples and blues. I think very, I'll put the picture back up. It's very representative, I think, of this picture. So I was happy to do that. And then the last thing, which is the crowning achievement of this monster update, is, oh, actually there are two things. Sorry. There's a mini skein set, which I already showed, which is Halloween candy themed. It's part of my Halloween release for 2016. This was not available as a pre-order earlier. If you had tuned in, you know, several episodes back, I had done Halloween pre-orders for the main Halloween colors, and then whoever ordered got a bonus mini, which was this one. I chose this one. This is the candy corn colorway, also known as the candy that everybody hates. This is an ombre, as you can tell. This is the Smarties, or the chalky candy that everybody eats but nobody likes. This is Double Bubble, or known as the gum that gets stale after 3 minutes of chewing. For me, these are Twizzlers. This is Red Licorice. Some people love Red Vines. I'm a Twizzlers girl. And then this is the best candy ever, which is caramel and chocolate. I was kind of inspired by the Twix bars, because those are my favorite for American candy anyway. So those are the colors that come in this set. This is $25 for all five little doodads. And again, you can use them for a bunch of things, but this will be up. There are four available in the mini skein set section. So if you like these mini skeins, go to the mini skein set section and you will find them there for you. And then, the crowning achievement of this update is going to be the pumpkin spice latte set. Okay, so you know I love Joanna and Gabby and their whole pumpkin along, and I'm like so into that, and I wanted to do something with this, and I don't know what I'm gonna do now. I'm like ticking down the minutes of things that I can do. Like, so I was really inspired. I'm like, I'm gonna dye some pumpkin yarn. And I went into it kind of anarchy style. I'm like, you know what? I'm just gonna go into it. I dyed that first set, the flowery like iris kind of thing, and I was like, what if I could do a pumpkin set? Let's do a pumpkin set. And then I was like, oh, what if I could do like a pumpkin spice latte and make it a set? And it's like pumpkin spice latte. Oh my God. So I did that. Get it for you. Pumpkin spice latte. I went totally white girl on this, but come on. Come on. Come on. Who doesn't love pumpkins and pumpkin spice latte? So I named each of the skeins because I was so geeking out about it. So this is pumpkin, and it's a tonal, and yes, I can repeat it. I don't plan on dyeing this again this year, but I dyed a ton. I dyed a couple on every single base that I have except Sparkle. So if you go into pretty much any section, Everyday Sock, Luxe DK, and Simple DK, you're going to find a set of pumpkin spice latte. So it's on your base of choice. Hopefully there's enough for everybody who wanted one. Excuse me. If there's not, I could do a second run of these, but it's limited. So I'm not going to dye it a ton this fall. You know, we're already ticking down in the fall. pumpkin spice latte. Pumpkin's autumnal. So this is what it kind of looks like in other bases. So again, we got a very similar feel. This is Simple DK. This is Everyday Sock. No, this is Luxe DK. This is Simple DK. This one came out a little fair bit darker. Maybe I'll make these a little darker. Everyday Sock. Luxe Sock. Pumpkin on every base. It's just a tonal. It's repeatable. It's just a tonal. Quite lovely. Again, I'm like all about this for a shawl. That would be so cool. Or a scarf or a hat or a set of mittens or, you know, you'd have plenty left over. This is Spice, which is a speckled. You can see the speckles there. This is a more of a burnt orange. So I have to wind these off, but this is in the, this is in Luxe Sock. Simple DK. And Luxe DK, you can see the speckles. It's a burnt orange. And then this is Latte. And guess what this is? It's an ombre. So I did an ombre style. So it's short transitions from like a deep coffee brown to that milky white. It's not, it's dyed. It's just a light, very, very light brown. Very nice saturation. I was very pleased with how this came out. So this will make a cool short color transitions from dark to light when you're stitching it. It'll pool, have some fun effects with that, make it look like a latte. I love you a latte. So pumpkin spice latte. It's a 200 gram set, so every set will be 200 grams. It's going to be 100 grams of pumpkin, and then 250 gram skeins, one of spice and one of latte in every base. So simple pumpkin spice latte. There, that will be a set. So I have to wind this into a 50 gram. There'll be two 50 gram balls. So there's gonna be two of each on each base. So hopefully there's enough for everybody, that everybody gets what they want, that they've been eyeing. I have been like total yarn spam on Instagram. I mean, it's my business Instagram, so of course I'm gonna yarn spam, but like, I've been like, oh my God, did you see this one of a kind colorway I just created? And like, just totally geeking out and like giving them cool like descriptions and stuff. I've been totally into this whole anarchy thing. So I went with it this week. I dyed what I wanted to dye. I didn't give myself restrictions. I just said like, you know what? If you're feeling it, just dye it. And so that's what I did. And I had a lot of fun. This has got to be my favorite pumpkin spice latte. Yes. Latte spice pumpkin. Anyway, I'm having too much fun. I hope you really enjoyed this week's podcast. Again, listen, it's so quiet. It's so quiet. I have a few hours before Cece's out so I can get this edited and uploaded and live, hopefully before I go to pick her up for preschool at 2 o'clock. I'll put on Instagram when it's live, which if you're seeing this, that was in the past, so I don't know why I'm even mentioning it to you. If this is the first episode you're watching and you'd like to watch more episodes, I'm going to link a playlist up here. These are my podcast episodes. I put every episode that I recorded into that playlist for your ease of watch. And then there are also detailed show notes. As always, they're right below the video. I always put them there. I always put them in Ravelry as well. On the Ravelry group, there's a new thread for every single episode, and it has detailed show notes along with pattern links. But everything is below. If you're watching this on YouTube, there's a link up here. If you click the little I button for my playlist, if this is, you know, the first episode you're watching, you want to go back to where it was super awkward and I was like, I don't know if I want to do this stuff, it's right there. And as always, you can find me on social media. Say hi. I love saying hi. Love chatting. Love meeting new people, new podcasters, new makers. What else do I want to say? If you're not subscribed and you'd like to be, make sure you hit the subscribe button. It's free. You don't have to pay anything for it. If you'd like to see this face every single week, you can do that. You don't have to pay for it. I don't charge unless you want to buy yarn. And you can buy some yarn. but you don't have to pay to watch. You can just subscribe if you like it. And that's about it. That's about it. So without any further ado, I'm concluding. I hope you have a lovely weekend. Saturday, 1 o'clock, shop update, Eastern Standard Time or Eastern Daylight Time. I think it's Standard Time right now. Who knows? Eastern Time, 1 p.m. So keep your ears to the alarm. I don't know, keep your alarm set. Oh, it's so awkward. I'm not even gonna edit that out because I'm just so awkward. Keep your ears perked up. I'm gonna put on Instagram when I go live at 1 o'clock, set your alarm so that you can get the yarn that you want, because there's lots of stuff here, lots of variety, lots of different fandom type things going on, and I want to make sure that you get what you want. So that's all. I will talk to you guys next time. Have a lovely weekend, and I'll see you later. Bye.